Time for another Marlin time capsule. We're gonna go to 1985, the only year I ever had to do summer school. I was in that class with quite a few people. One namely would be Dennis DeCarney, and we would walk home together, but I would never make it home. He would take me to this little corner drugstore, like real mom and pop, like from the 50s style drugstore that still exists today. And we walk here over by the Methodist Church, smoke a couple cigarettes, right? And we would hang right here at the corner. And that little drugstore coffee shop was right there, and it still exists today. Let's go take a look. And of course, there's Dickie Spadafora Jr. representing. So let's see if I can pull this off. There was like a little bar in there. You'd walk in, it was a drugstore and a little ice cream bar. And all we would do was like right over here. So we would go to order milkshakes, old school milkshakes. But as you can see, it's torn down. It's not the same. It's just a regular convenience store now, but Dennis will remember, Joe Doherty will remember. We would go to the bar, just like George Bailey in It's a Wonderful Life. Drugstore dash ice cream place. You get your milkshakes. Coming out, sir? You're welcome. And then I would walk down here, and then I would head to Porter Street. That was the summer of 85. And stop at 7-Eleven. It was the year that the Cherry Coke came out. I'd always get a Cherry Coke. We'll take a look at it. So I would walk back this way from after getting a milkshake with Dennis DeCarney from Julie the Druggist. I would stop back here with my $2 and change I'd get from my father's couch cushion and stop in this place, which was White Hen Pantry, the local convenience store. I would load up on my Cherry Coke, pack of smokes, and maybe some Ding Dongs. This was before I discovered the expired Hostess produce down the street that you could get for 10 cents on the dollar. So I would sit there, take my swig, and then make my way up to Porter Street. From here, the trek would begin, and I would already be about 2 cigarettes deep before I got to this point. The Gales lived over here. There was a garage out back. I remember that. And then I would be gassed by this point, so I'd crawl the rest of the way before we got to Grand Central Station, the Doherty residence. This was the first stop of my day after summer school. Now, Joe, help me out. Was it this house? Or was it this house? Was it 34, or did they knock it down? Guy's getting suspicious of me. I think it was this one, because I would sit here for a couple of hours and we would look for snacks that Joe's mom would maybe leave, and smoke some more cigarettes out here. Joe, what is this your older place, or was it here? Was it torn down? Anyhow, upward we would go. Joe, was it this place? Was it this place? Maybe. Maybe it was here. So as we would leave Joe's house, we would start to accumulate numbers somehow. Some people would go add on to us, but slowly we would march. Gotta give respect, pay homage to the Giuliano house. R.I.P. Debbie, get this motherfucker behind me, away from me. The Giuliano house was one of the stops that we would add on. And then, next thing you know, we were about 15 deep. 15 deep. Charisse White lived over there. I didn't know her then. 15 deep, and this was the place. Starboard Street. That was the next installment of our day. Now, before we got to our destination, this was the first time I ever seen Peter Croce. Now, I think it was this house, or maybe, no, I think it was this house. Now, Peter, the first time I ever saw him, he would always carry his Washburn guitar around everywhere he went, with his hair flying around. He carried around like it was his girlfriend. I was like, who the hell is that guy? I hope to get to know him later in life. This was the destination, Penny's house. Penny, is this the right house? This was the destination. We would park here, smoke more cigarettes. Penny's parents were so lovely. They were always like, come on in, kids, just stay out of trouble. Then, as the day would continue, as you can see, we would move in small increments. We would go to Walcott Street. Now, the Gula house was here. We would always spend a lot of time here in the later hours. And then kind of move our way down the hill here. Now, I can remember doing mescaline for the first time at the top of this hill and sitting at the top waiting for it to kick in. Three or four of us did it. It was, I'll leave those names out, but it was the Green Star was the first type of acid introduced to us. But we all took it, and when it kicked in, I literally, like, I felt like I was rolling down the hill to get to home school to start the trip. And, go to home school in the back of the parking lot, and that was like the place to be. We would go in back of there and with a bottle of Indian ink, a needle, and a thread, and give ourselves some tattoo crosses out in the public. Yes, we gave ourselves tattoos. Not believable, except for the people that know from my generation that can verify this and show their tattoos, the Indian ink crosses. Here we are. This is the home school. Yeah. And we would hang here, out back here at during the summer nights when school was out of session. Now one day, I had a couple of fist fights in this year, summer of 85. And let's see how things are looking. Things are looking almost the same. But yeah, I had a couple of bangers here. Couple of fist fights, and one of them was with my good old friend Peter Nelson. We fought right here, or shall I say he fought, and I had another one out here in the middle. But back up there, that's where we used to go up to the mount. And this big Kev sitting in my car like saying, what the fuck is he doing? What is my crazy brother doing? He wants no part of this. So when we got sick of that area, we'd go left. We'd set our destination left to go see what was on this side of the neighborhood. Now, if my memory serves me correctly, which it does fail me, the townhouses. Where are the townhouses? There they are. If I'm not mistaken, Melissa Jean Tiberio, you might have lived here at one time or another, right? Correct me if I'm wrong. The Ledgewood Estates. These, of course, were all dark brown like caca. These used to be that someone thought enough to change the color. But my dear friend Peter S. Scott lived here. I spent many times here. Melissa Jean, I don't know which one you lived in, but I thought you lived here around 1985-ish or so. I loved this place. This was like a little secret haven, a secret spot. Now, I don't know how the hell to get out of here. I don't know if there's a back way out, but we will see. Had a lot of fun here. It was safe, you know what I mean? If you wanted to get away from certain people, like the bullies, the neighborhood bullies of this area, I'm going to leave names out, but I'm sure you could name them. I would flip out here. This was like the little secret back entrance. Now, one time, Joe Daugherty and I, and my cousin Billy, we were just kind of walking in this car, Monte Carlo SS or something like that, overfilled his gas tank, and he sped up this hill, and there was gas coming out of his tank, and it made a stripe right up this hill. So we're like, what should we do? That's for smoking cigarettes. So we lit it. We lit the stripe of gas and it went all the way up the hill. Nobody would believe that story but Joe Daugherty because he was there. But yes, we lit it on fire. We did shit like that in the 80s. So I would get at the top of here. Kimball Street. I used to know someone who lived on Kimball Street. It was a long way down, and I would be totally out of gas. But she was worth it. She was worth it. I do believe there maybe was a tree here, but this was the spot right here. I'd spend many days just kind of loitering out just to hope that she would come out, but I can't remember her name. I hope that she's well. Kevin, what just happened here as we're doing our documentary? What just happened?
He didn't even fucking stop.
Big Kev is not in approval of this driver here. So like I said, through the schoolyard entrance across the street, that's how we would get up here. Wait Mount, AKA the Mount. You'd have to be very careful up here because this is where the tough guys would hang out. I'm going to leave out the names because you know who you are and people know who they are. And you kind of just had to keep your mouth shut. And you really didn't wind up in any trouble. I'm going to do a quick walk around here, show you where I used to get fucked up. Oh, wait a minute. They have some parking. Yeah. I can't do a half-assed documentary on the Mount and not do a runaround. So yeah, we would come up here all our lungs full of fucking tobacco and weed. We'd get skunked beers and we'd do our drinking up here. Now again, the tough guys all were up here and you kind of had to take your chances whether you were gonna get beat up or not. Depends on what type of mood they're in, but most of them were pretty lenient. Most of them didn't like go out of their weight class. Here we are, the Mount. So some people fell down this hill. Remember one time Joe Daugherty threw a rock at me, Palator. My good friend hit him with a rock, had a concussion. We just let it go. So before Big Kev gets killed by the people in the basketball court, we're just gonna say hello and goodbye to the Mount. The Mount. It's a lot nicer than I remember it. They must have made some changes. Nice private basketball game up here. Big Kev sitting in the car like, what the fuck is my brother doing? Big Kev, what do you think of your brother's documentary on the Malden pieces? Are you enjoying them?
Yeah.
Yeah? In other words, you'd like to get the fuck out of here.
Yeah.